Hello, this is Akram Jafar, and in this video I'm going to deal with some picture tests in practical anatomy of the lower limb. This video deals with the gluteal region and hamstring compartment. You may use the video as a revision or as a self-assessment tool. For the purpose of self-assessment, pause the video and spend some time to read the question and come up with the answer. Then replay the video to confirm your answer by listening to the comments and explanations. What is the origin of numbered arteries 1 and 3? This is a plastic model showing the back of the gluteal region and the proximal part of the hamstring compartment here. And here is the gluteus minimus muscle. This is the piriformis muscle, pear-shaped muscle that is attached to the greater trochanter here. This is the key of the gluteal region. So above piriformis is the superior gluteal artery, and this is a branch of the internal iliac artery in the pelvis. Same thing is true for this artery below piriformis. That's why it's called the inferior gluteal artery. And it is, again, it's a branch of the internal iliac artery in the pelvis. This artery here below the quadratus femoris is a branch of the medial circumflex femoral artery, which is a branch of the profunda femoris, the deep femoral artery, arises from the femoral artery in the femoral triangle. Which of the numbered vessels traverses the greater sciatic notch? So these two vessels here, 1 and 2, in addition to piriformis, in addition to the superior gluteal nerve, inferior gluteal nerve, all of them, they traverse the greater sciatic notch, as well as the sciatic nerve and the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh. This young athlete felt a sudden popping sensation while playing basketball and presents with weak hip flexion and knee extension. Her x-ray confirmed an avulsed bone here. This is the avulsed bone. Name two structures attached to the avulsed bone. Now, if you look at the bone here, this is the iliac crest, and the iliac crest ends anteriorly as the anterior superior iliac spine. So the avulsed bone is not at the anterior superior iliac spine. It is below that. It is at the anterior inferior iliac spine. Remember that the anterior inferior iliac spine provides attachment to a muscle, which is the rectus femoris muscle. This is a member of the quadriceps femoris group, but it is the only member that crosses the hip joint. The other members, they don't cross the hip, they arise from the femur, and then the four muscles have a common attachment to the patella, where they participate in knee extension. But rectus femoris muscle also causes hip flexion. So when it causes avulsion of the bone to which it is attached, the tendon of the rectus femoris muscle, this results in weak hip flexion. It doesn't stop hip flexion because there are other important hip flexors, like the psoas major and the iliacus muscle are hip flexors. Sartorius is a hip flexor. Pectineus is a hip flexor, but it becomes a little bit weak because one of the flexors will be affected, and also it causes a weakness in the extension because the other members are still intact. The vasti are still intact. The other structure that is attached to the anterior inferior iliac spine is the very strong ligament of the hip joint, the iliofemoral ligament, the Y-shaped ligament. This ligament is attached to the anterior inferior iliac spine, and then it splits into two bands, like an inverted Y-shape. This ligament is a very strong ligament because it's important for the stability of the hip joint and prevents hyperextension of the hip joint. Remember that the anterior superior iliac spine also provides the attachment of a muscle and a ligament, but the muscle here in the anterior superior iliac spine is the sartorius and the ligament is the inguinal ligament. Identify the muscles A and B. What is the nerve supply of each? The muscle B here is located proximal to gluteus maximus. In fact, part of the muscle is covered by gluteus maximus, but it is not completely covered by gluteus maximus. This is the gluteus medius muscle, and it is supplied by the superior gluteal nerve. Gluteus medius muscle completely overlies the gluteus minimus. So if we reflect the gluteus maximus, we will not be able to see the gluteus minimus. We can only see the gluteus medius muscle, and then cutting the gluteus medius and reflecting it will allow us to see the underlying gluteus minimus. But gluteus medius muscle can be seen above the gluteus maximus, although it is covered partly by it. Here you can see the iliotibial tract, the thickening of the deep fascia of the thigh, to which 3/4 of gluteus maximus is attached. So this is the lateral side of the thigh, and the muscle here is the vastus lateralis muscle. This is not the tensor fasciae latae. Tensor fasciae latae is located more anteriorly, but this is located laterally, and the muscle actually rises from the linea aspera of the femur and is related to the lateral side of the femur, the vastus lateralis muscle. These muscles here are the hamstring muscles, the semitendinosus, and the biceps muscle. Now, vastus lateralis, as part of the quadratus femoris muscle, as a member of the anterior compartment of the thigh, is supplied by the femoral nerve. Identify the structure A, name the ligament attached to it. Identify the bony prominence B, name two muscles attached to it. Now, this is an axial CT showing the lower part of the pelvis and the upper part of the perineum. You can see here the anteriorly is the pubic symphysis. This is the acetabulum articulating with the head of the femur. This is the neck of the femur, and laterally located is the greater trochanter of the femur. Now, attached to the head of the femur, the ligament that is attached to the head of the femur, to a pit on the head of the femur, this is the ligament of the head of the femur, round ligament of the femur. And the muscles attached to the greater trochanter, we have gluteus medius and minimus muscle are attached to the greater trochanter. Also attached to the tip of the greater trochanter is the piriformis muscle. And to the medial side of the greater trochanter, we have the obturator internus and obturator externus muscles. So all these muscles are attached to the greater trochanter of the femur. Deep dissection at the back of the hip joint. Identify the bony structures. You can see here, this is the entire area, and this is the quadrangular area, the inset. So here's the medial side, is located here, and that bony prominence is the ischial tuberosity. This is the femur, you can see it here on the lateral side, the greater trochanter of the femur, the lesser trochanter of the femur. This is the intertrochanteric crest, and here is the neck of the femur. You can still see the neck of the femur here, because the capsule of the hip joint does not reach the intertrochanteric crest posteriorly. The capsule of the hip joint covers the entire neck anteriorly because it reaches the intertrochanteric line. But posteriorly, there's an area of the neck which is not covered by the capsule. This area
has the tendon of obturator externus playing against it.
Here you can see the obturator internus and the gemelli, and this is the sciatic nerve coming from below piriformis, and these are the common peroneal and the tibial components of the sciatic nerve. You can see that the sciatic nerve leaves the gluteal region midway between the ischial tuberosity and the greater trochanter of the femur. Which of the following muscles is attached to bone and deep fascia? So let's identify the muscles here. We have the gluteus maximus reflected. You can see the structures under gluteus maximus. Here's the gluteus medius muscle, and this muscle is attached to the ilium and the greater trochanter of the femur. This is the key muscle of the gluteal region, piriformis, attached to the sacrum and the greater trochanter. This is the quadratus femoris muscle, attached to the ischial tuberosity and the quadrate tubercle of the femur. Here, this is the hamstring muscle that goes laterally. This is the biceps femoris muscle. It's attached to the ischial tuberosity proximally, and distally it's attached to the fibula. Gluteus maximus muscle, proximally it is attached to a ligament, sacrotuberous ligament, as well as to the ilium. Distally it is attached to the gluteal tuberosity, which is a rough area here, distal to the greater trochanter of the femur. This is only 1/4 of the muscle, but 3/4 of the muscle is attached to this thickening of deep fascia, which is called the iliotibial tract. So gluteus maximus is the muscle that is attached to both bone and deep fascia. Identify the muscles A and B. These muscles are the hamstring muscles. You can see this is the gluteus maximus muscle. This is the gluteal region. And this is the posterior aspect of the thigh. Look at the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh passing superficial to these muscles. The muscle that goes to the lateral side is the biceps femoris muscle. And the muscle on the medial side is the semitendinosus muscle. Deep to it is the semimembranosus. What is the proximal attachment of each? The proximal attachment of each is the common origin of the hamstrings, and this is the ischial tuberosity. What is the distal attachment of each? The semitendinosus muscle is attached to the medial side of the knee. It's attached to the upper part of the medial aspect of the tibia, together with sartorius and gracilis, forming what we call the pes anserinus. While the biceps femoris muscle, this is the, in fact, to be specific, this is the long head of biceps femoris muscle. It will fuse with the short head of biceps distally, and both of them, they are attached lateral to the knee. They are attached to the head of the fibula. In this dissection of the gluteal region, which numbered muscles is considered as the key to other structures in the region? The key of the gluteal region is the piriformis muscle, and here, although this is very dry and shrunken specimen, plastinated model, but I can say that this is the piriformis muscle for the following reason. The reason that it passes through the greater sciatic notch, it originates in the pelvis and passes through the greater sciatic notch. It has the sciatic nerve inferior to the muscle, and the muscle is attached to the greater trochanter of the femur. While this muscle here, this is the gluteus medius muscle, is attached to the greater trochanter of the femur. Here, this is the bunch of the gemelli and the tendon of obturator internus, and this tendon here is the tendon of obturator externus. Usually, you cannot see this tendon unless you remove the muscle which is located superficial to it, the muscle that is quadrangular shaped muscle here, the quadratus femoris muscle. Which group of thigh muscles is attached to bone at location A and B? So this is an posterior anterior view of the hip region, and this is the pubic bone, superior ramus, pubic tubercle. This is the body of the pubis, pubic symphysis, inferior ramus of the pubis. The pubic bone provides attachment for the adductor muscles, adductor longus, adductor brevis, gracilis, pectineus muscle, and also the part of the adductor magnus, but adductor magnus continues to the ischium, ramus of the ischium, and the ischial tuberosity, B. And this is the hamstring portion of adductor magnus. So B provides the attachment of the hamstrings, including the hamstring portion of adductor magnus, a long head of biceps, semitendinosus, and semimembranosus muscle. These muscles, the hamstring muscles, are all, they are supplied by the sciatic nerve, while the adductor muscles are supplied by the obturator nerve. Identify the surface A. This is showing the acetabulum, and this is the smooth surface, horseshoe-shaped, and so it's called the lunate surface of the acetabulum. Lunate means like a moon, and this is the articular surface of the acetabulum. Here's the non-articular part of the acetabulum. It contains a pad of fat, and this is the articular, smooth articular surface of the lunate surface of the acetabulum. The fibrocartilage attached to the green colored line at the rim of the acetabulum, there is a fibrocartilage that deepens the acetabulum, and this is called the acetabular labrum. It is comparable to the glenoid labrum of the shoulder joint. And as I said, that its function is to deepen the cavity of the acetabulum and thus provides for stability of the hip joint. Identify the nerve A, name the plexus from which it is derived. This is a dissection of the gluteal region. You can see the gluteus maximus has been cut and reflected. The nerve is the largest nerve in the body. It leaves the pelvis through the greater sciatic notch below piriformis. It is the sciatic nerve. You can see here it has two components, the tibial and common peroneal components. This is the common situation of the nerve, that the two components are fused together as they leave the pelvis. And then as they reach the popliteal fossa, at the apex of the popliteal fossa, they will split. Sometimes they split earlier. Sometimes they split within the pelvis so that the tibial component passes below piriformis and the common peroneal component passes through piriformis or even above piriformis. The sciatic nerve is a branch of the sacral plexus. It is derived from L4, 5, S1, 2, and 3, and it is the biggest nerve in the body. B, identify the muscle, which movement it produces. This muscle is the quadrangular shaped muscle. It's a small muscle behind the femur. attached to the femur, so it's quadratus femoris. Don't confuse it with the quadriceps femoris, the muscle with the forehead that is located in the anterior compartment of the thigh. The muscle has horizontal fibers, and as I said, it extends between the ischium and the femur. There's a quadrate tubercle here on the intertrochanteric crest, and so the muscle laterally rotates the femur. It is one of the muscles that are also important for the stability of the hip joint, and is supplied by a nerve that carries the name of the muscle, although the nerve also supplies the inferior gemellus muscle, the nerve to quadratus femoris muscle. Now this muscle, as you can see here, has been dissected. If we remove the muscle, then deep to the muscle we can find the tendon of obturator externus passing laterally and upward to reach the medial aspect or the base of the greater trochanter of the femur. Which of the hamstring muscles 1 to 4 does not act on the hip joint? So let's look at these muscles. We have this muscle is superficial muscle. It's on the lateral side. Look here. Look, this is the lateral side. This is the iliotibial tract. And look at the gluteus maximus. 3/4 of it is attached to the iliotibial tract. The muscle here is the vastus lateralis. But we are talking about these hamstring muscles, which are attached to the ischial tuberosity, going downwards and laterally. This is the long head of biceps femoris muscle. And as the name indicates, biceps has two heads. So this is the long head, and this is the short head of biceps. It arises from the femur, from the lateral supracondylar line, and the linea aspera of the femur arises from the back of the femur and fuses with the long head. So the long head arises from the common origin of the hamstrings, the ischial tuberosity. The muscles that arise from the ischial tuberosity means that they cross the hip joint and they act on the hip joint. The long head acts on the hip joint, but the short head of biceps, which arises from the femur, therefore does not act on the hip joint, but it acts on the knee joint. It flexes the knee and then laterally rotates the flexed knee. The two muscles here on the medial side, the most superficial one is the semitendinosus muscle. You can see its long tendon here. And the other one, deep to it, is the semimembranosus, which has a flat tendon deep to this area, not shown, deep to the semitendinosus. That's why it's called the semimembranosus. Both semitendinosus and semimembranosus are attached to the ischial tuberosity. They extend the hip, flex the knee, and both of them, they medially rotate the flexed knee. So it's only muscle 1, which is the short head of biceps femoris, that does not act on the hip joint. Identify the angles A and B. What is the approximate normal value of each? Now let's look at the first angle, A. This is the angle where the long axis of the neck of the femur meets the long axis of the body of the femur, and it is called the angle of inclination. The angle varies with age, sex, and development of the femur. The normal value in the male is about 126 degrees. In the female, with her wider pelvis, the angle is smaller. So it's about 126 degrees in the male, 120 degrees in the female. A pathological decrease in the angle of inclination results in a clinical condition called coxavara, and an increase in the angle of inclination, pathological increase, results in a condition called coxa valga. The other angle here, B, is called the angle of torsion. You can see here that the head of the femur passes upwards medially and forwards. So the long axis of the neck of the femur makes an angle with the axis that passes through the condyles of the femur located distally. And this is called the angle of torsion. It is about 12 degrees.